I'm really excited. I'm on my way out to the Newberry Cave, which is near Barstow, California, in the central eastern Mojave Desert. And what's so cool about this cave is it's a singularity amongst ritual sites, in that there are so many things that were found in this cave that were completely unique to any place else. To start with, it's the only place in California where split twig figurines have been found. This split twig figurine tradition is actually originated in Arizona in the Grand Canyon area, and somehow made its way down to California, to the Southern California desert. Also related to those split twig figurines is that in that cave there are pictographs of quadrupeds from the archaic era. That means that they were painted around or before the year 1500 BCE. There are no other painted pictographs of quadrupeds in that area dating to the archaic era, only petroglyphs. And what's unique about the pictographs is some of them are green, which is a unique color to appear in this region. The green comes from a rock that is actually a volcanic rock that water has washed over and over and over for eons and turned it into this green rock. It's actually a pretty common rock, but it only appears in certain pockets, and it appears right there by the Newberry Cave. And this green rock, this pigment, was used throughout the cave, on the walls, on the artifacts found in there, so much green paint. There were about 1,000 atlatl shafts found in this cave. Many of them had green paint on them. Also, there were like ritual wands, like piece of quartz stuck with tar to a stick that were painted green. Lots of stones painted green. There was a skeleton of a Shasta ground sloth found in there that dated to 11,500, but human use of the cave only started, I think it was about 1,000 BCE.
Yeah, no, it was 2,000 BCE.
So, it's a really cool place and I can't wait to see it.
We're so lucky. This might actually be a naturally occurring little deposit of chalcedonite that was used to paint those green pictographs. This is obviously volcanic rock. This is obviously a drainage, old drainage. Water would have been running over this rock for a really long time and turning it that green color. That's amazing. Newberry Cave is at the dead end of a canyon. I mean, this is a hard wall dead end of this canyon. It's right behind that big boulder. And look at this, almost without fail at an epic ritual site, you see quartz everywhere. It's either all over the ground, or as in this case, it's embedded in a strata of this rock that is obviously full of quartz. I mean, at one time, this was a whole layer of quartz exposed that's now been eroded away. And from a chemical perspective, quartz has a heat. It has a higher heat than other rocks, which means it vibrates faster than other rocks. It has a vibe, right? And this is also drainage, a huge, hard, fast drainage, because water falls off up there and just cuts down hard through this. So when you get water interacting with a vibey rock, it's vibey. The place is vibey, and that's why you find ritual sites at vibey places. Vibey means it literally vibrates. And people who live up there all the time could feel that easily. You can feel it too when you walk into a room. You can feel the vibes of a place. You can feel it in the outdoors too if you get used to it. So here's a piece of a beautiful big bird. And this is giving me pause because I haven't quite rounded the corner to the cave yet. And I'm wondering if there's a huge predator that lives in there.
I'm here and I'm excited to go in because I can already see pigment on the wall behind me. But this case, first things first, for sure, because the one of the first looters of this cave was were guano miners, which means this thing is full of poop. When they actually officially excavated this cave, the whole back portion of it was just stacked with poop. I am not interested in dying of hantavirus, not today. So, I came ready. I'm gonna geek out a little bit extra on this pictograph right here. It is the pictograph of a handprint, and I'm just gonna hover over it. Look at how small it is compared to the size of my hand. Like, I can almost cut the whole thing between these two fingers. This one is a funny, controversial pictograph because in the earliest reports of this cave, it was reported that this handprint was here. And then when archaeologists came to do work on the cave, they said it had disappeared. And the reason they thought it had disappeared is because they were looking in the wrong place. They thought it should be over there where all of those pictographs of the quadrupeds are, when it's over here on the opposite wall. Still there as ever was. A lot of times when exploring, quote, caves, they're really just rock shelters, but I think this can pretty well qualify as a real live cave because it's cavey, it's dark, it's all the way inside a rock. It's not just a bunch of tumble of boulders that, you know, are making a cave-like area. This is an actual cave inside the hillside. And there's that glistening ceiling full of poop. See all these little crevices and cubbies everywhere. In the Grand Canyon, in caves where, ritual caves where the split twig figurines are found, they're found tucked into these little crevices and these little pockets. I'll talk a little bit more about what the hypothesis or theory about that is when I show you how to make a split twig figurine. But
it's related to how the split twig figurines were found in this cave. There were, was it seven?
This is the voice of the cave. There were actually 11
figurines found in this cave and about 1,000 fragments. And then all over the floor of the cave were found rocks like this, painted green. And again, the thought about that is that that's related to the figurines. At first, people thought maybe it was that they were pallets used for grinding up the rock, but that's not the case. Because the surfaces, even razor thin side surfaces, were painted. Also, the atlatl shafts and other artifacts that were found in the cave were painted with this this paint. The idea is that it's probably was some kind of the painting of that pigment itself was part of the ritual. And again, I'll explain a little bit more about what those rocks actually might have been when I show you how to make a split twig figurine. There were grass beds found in here. Oh yeah, and that ground sloth, the Shasta ground sloth bones. Unfortunately, the cave had been too disturbed by the time academics came to look at the placement of all the artifacts, including the bones and the figurines as related to the sloth bones. But in Arizona caves, where the split twig figurines are found, bones of extinct animals were used in cooperation with the figurines as kind of an altar situation. So the artifacts in the cave were used together. It's possible that's what was happening here as well. The thought that this cave had any kind of domestic use has been pretty much discarded because of the kind of artifacts that have been found in here. There was only one mono found and no basketry. And there were a couple of things for fire starting, but not really enough. And but lots and lots and lots of ritual items. So it's pretty much concluded that the Newberry Cave was 100% ritual cave.
The reason this is important kind of archaeologically is because this cave uniquely blends, marries, uses as a cross-reference pictographs and artifacts that were found in the cave that appeared to be used in concert at the same time. So from there you can extrapolate what the meaning of this was. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that while I show you how to make one of these with a split twig.
First of all, to put the Newberry Cave in context with its landscape, in that area, the Mojave Desert, from between about the years 8,000 to 6,000 BCE, there were Great Lakes. People lived all around the Great Lakes that were out there in what are now these dry, sandy lake beds. And then around the year 5,000 BCE, there was intense warming, which completely changed how people lived out there. The lakes dried up, dependable water sources became not the lakes, but streams or springs. And isolated lakes. So the water situation became different, which caused a little bit of a diaspora, and people became more seasonally nomadic. It changed the way people ate. They were hunters, but temporary camps would be used for the hunting season and the gathering season. And by the year of four or 500 CE, people were primarily dependent on gathering instead of hunting. And that would indicate two things. One, that there was a rich supply of food to gather, and two, there was probably less supply of food to hunt. And maybe this had something to do with the climatic change that had been happening since about the year 6000 BCE, becoming drier and drier. The big game became more and more scarce, and that's probably why you see a proliferation of these this hunting magic, these petroglyphs and pictographs depicting game animals. The split twig figurines were invented in the Grand Canyon as ritualistic increase totems, and they've been radiocarbon dated there to have been used between 2900 BCE and 1250 BCE. The tradition, though, spread from the Grand Canyon area of Arizona to Utah, Nevada, and one California site, which is the Newberry Cave. Now, these kind of figurines are found in different contexts, too. There are domestic uses of these figurines, because you can find them in other parts of the Southwest, and even in Mexico, in historic times, and even today, these figurines are reproduced as split twig figurines and in little food items, too, that are shaped like these animals. And they're used somewhat ritualistically in the sense that they're part of religious ceremonies, but they're also kind of just social, I don't know, I wouldn't call them toys, but totems used in festival events. The figurines in the Newberry Cave have been determined to be ritual because one of the figurines that was found had a piece of chalcedony, that's that green rock that makes the green pictographs, wrapped in grass and woven into, you know, inside of the figurine. Now, this is exactly how they did in the Grand Canyon ritual tradition, where some of them were found with dung, animal dung, wrapped inside the figurine. Some of them were found pierced with sticks, like to represent spears. And this is how we know that it was some kind of hunting magic. It was a whatever kind of dung was found inside that animal was meant, what gave it the identity of that animal it was supposed to be. And then when ritually killing it with a little stick, represented killing it with an atlatl. So that would be, you know, praying for or representing or magically creating a successful hunt. In the Grand Canyon areas where the figurines are found, some of the figurines were placed into these altar-like settings where they would be in the middle of a grass-lined pit, much like what was found in the Newberry Cave, and then surrounded with prehistoric animal bones as if they were encaged within those bones. Now, those green painted stones that were found in the Newberry Cave originally were thought maybe to be pallets, but now are thought to possibly be similar to what those prehistoric animal bones used as part of an altar with the split twig figurines, perhaps even placed in alignment with a figurine at the center and these standing stones painted green on the outside, encaging the animal, and thus representing, you know, the entrapment of the animal, or somehow, you know, ritually harnessing the spirit of the animal. And although we don't know for sure, it is reasonable to guess that those sloth bones that were found in the Newberry Cave could have been used in the same way that they were used in the Grand Canyon as, you know, part of the altar, is part of the cage. I'm sure these rituals were repeated over and over again in the same caves year after year. We know that the Newberry Cave was in ritual use for about 500 years. So that's a lot of time to have to repeat the ritual over and over again and use different materials and methods. But it seems like the ritual stayed pretty consistent because of those 1,050 atlatl shafts that were found. It would take a long time to accumulate that many. Out here in front of the cave, it seems like people from the archaic era used to sit in front of this cave and make projectile points, because there were projectile points found dating from 2000 BCE up to 600 CE. Taking all of the artifacts into consideration, the thinking is that this was a ritual cave related to what's called hunting magic. And so coming to this ritual cave and making the weapons that you'll hunt the animal with, and probably thus blessing the weapons
and also asking the world to create more of that animal you want to hunt would be the purpose of this cave. It's imbued with the power of the hunt. Now I'm just going to do a little thought experiment to give a sense of how this cave is thought to have been used, rooted in the ways that the ancient Uto-Aztecans did think about the process of life and death. So deep in the back of this cave, over 1,000 atlatl shafts were ritually buried or retired to the depths of the earth. Now, when something dies in the Uto-Aztecan world, it goes to the underworld and then recycles back into life. So the spirits of things that have died regenerate into new life. Of course, that's just how life works. If a plant dies, it regenerates into some other form of new life. But let's say that, okay, so we've retired our atlatls that were presumably from a successful hunt, and they're sacrificed in gratitude for that hunt and put into the ritual cave. And then the spirits of all of those animals that had given their life are honored and recognized and thanked and released back out into the world, into the universe, to propagate as new animals to feed the people. So when the ritual works in this circular way, from dark to light, from death to rebirth, it's cyclical, there's gratitude, there is both a sense of gratitude and supplication for more. It's honoring a cycle. And it's not just taking for granted that that food is going to keep coming. It's thanking the food for being there, for existing, and for continuing to exist in the future. It's winter in the Mojave Desert, and I am freezing. I'm sitting in this little rock shelter that has this little, what's apparently just a wind tunnel in it. I don't know why I'm sitting here, because I'm looking at the Newberry Cave and I'm thinking about this really interesting place that we just saw together. I just want to say a little word about magic. So everybody can do magic. You can walk into a room and you can change the vibe of that room by how you behave, by how your body language is. You walk into a room that has five people in there and you walk in with a certain body language, you are going to influence the whole tone of that room. You can either bring it up or you can really intimidate, right? That is the essence of magic. It's the influence of power. It's using your personal power to influence the world around you. That's all magic is. And so when some people are more powerful at using their magic, then some their reach goes further and further. Some people are world leaders. They use their magic to influence great numbers of people. Some people can actually manipulate physical powers of the earth. That's when we get into things that some people think are just kind of woo-woo. But then again, there is chemistry, and chemistry shows that you can, by, you know, making certain manipulations with the natural world, you can influence it. So that's the nature of magic, and that's the nature of what people were doing in this cave. They were trying to influence their physical world through shifting power. And when there's a little bit of tension, people try to control the uncontrollable. And sometimes they use what we would call magic, ritual, ceremony, in ways that we don't fully understand because we don't intuit that way to think anymore. All right, so thank you for this. I hope you have a wonderful day, and I really appreciate you joining me. Hop on over to the Facebook group Ancient Southwest and share your adventures there. You can go to the website, theancientsouthwest.com. There I support this channel with the bead art that I make, and see if there's something you like. You can link over to my Etsy shop there and see if there's maybe a Valentine's gift you want to buy for somebody. May the fire inside you continue to burn brightly.